So, hello everybody. Hopefully this will be a live as we are speaking. We are waiting for others to join our little first session. Unlike some of the others, what I will do, I will just start talking from the beginning. Simply because I think when people are watching this in archive mode, it actually makes a little bit more sense to do that while people are joining in. I'm also watching myself on an iPad, so that I kind of see what you are seeing and hearing what you are hearing. So let me start right away while more people sort of join in. If you're already in the chat, please confirm that the audio and the video is good enough for you while we are moving about. So I wanted to do these live sessions, and I already did two tests. Simply so that both on the YouTube channel and on the Facebook that we are, I'm partly running, because I'm an admin on a Facebook group called A7R3 Setup Tips. And if you're not part of it, please join. And there's always a lot of questions. And I myself am not a professional. I'm just sort of doing this for fun. But when I'm learning or when I'm doing something, I'm quite technical, I usually make small videos and share them on the internet. And starting from that point, I was like, okay, if it just helps a few people, it's fun to do and it doesn't cost me too much work. And you can see that if you're watching my videos in the production value, I normally just aim the camera to to a couch or a table thingy that I have in my home theater, and just record. Once the recording is done, I will just take the whole file and upload it to YouTube without any editing. And the same plan I have over here. I want to do it as, I would say, as simple as possible. And the way that I want to do it is that I can just walk around in my own room. I'm not saying I'm going to take a toilet break, that would be a little bit extreme, but I am able, because I normally don't appear in the picture, not because I don't want to, but because it's just more work. It does give me the freedom to walk around, get a new lens, show you something in the menu, even maybe go back to my computer and see what else is being said in the chat if I've missed something on my iPad. I also made the setup that I can walk around using an iPad, and I hear the audio, and I'm wired using a wireless mic. So yeah, let's get going. Hopefully more people will join. We only have four people now, I think. So that's not too much yet, but we will see. Let me start it up again, just to make sure if I, oh, there's now six people. So please, if you are joining, say something in the chat. So that I know that you are there and if you can hear this correctly. So what I want to do is talk about several topics until sort of a question pops up where we can jump into. I will also try to look a little bit on what's being asked on YouTube and Facebook, what might be interesting topics to talk about. So today's first topic I want to talk about is if you're not an Apple user, you might not. But I think something very interesting happened last week when Apple introduced their new iPads. And I think it's so interesting that it will affect photography in a big way. And not maybe because of the new camera that they built in, but actually because of the new iPads. So they are now becoming so powerful that I think we are going to see for photographers I wouldn't say a better way, but a change in how some of our tools might be working. So up to now, we had computers which are quite generic, quite generically built for all kinds of tasks in the world. But Apple is more and more moving to creating special CPUs and special processors and special, although closed, and there's a lot of argument against that and for that. But they are tuning their hardware very much to certain use cases. And what I noticed when looking at the latest iPads, that they are extremely powerful in certain areas, and areas which are very interesting for us. I now use myself an iPad Pro, and I will probably also upgrade to a new iPad Pro. And what I noticed that things like photography power, if that makes sense, is much higher than on most of my laptops, including mine laptops. My iPad has way less problems handling 4K material, for example, multiple streams, or doing Lightroom adjustments. And what we have seen this week is basically an important step in both the CPU power and support. So Adobe was on the show, and they also showed now totally working version of Photoshop. So they always had a version of Lightroom available, but they are now also releasing, hopefully in the next few months, a total version of Photoshop for the iPad. And I think that's very interesting, combined with one hardware change they are making, which relates to our cameras again. Up to now, of course, they had their own connectors for all kinds of reasons, a bad reason or good reasons. They had their the Lightning connector, and before that they had the 30-pin connector. But the iPad Pro is now the first Apple device that comes with a USB-C. And that's very interesting, not because you need less dongles, but also for the opportunities that it will give in the future. Because that means, and they already talked about this a little bit, that unlike with the Lightning connector, it's basically much more up to the software connecting to the iPad and the software that runs it, how it gets handled. So one journalist, for example, asked what happens if I connect a certain printer to the iPad Pro. And the people from Apple were reacting, "We don't know. You have to see, because we don't know what they are doing in the software from the program side." And that's actually very interesting if we think about that Sony, in one of their demo setups, was actually connecting the A7 III to the new iPads, clearly showing that they are using that as a test case, but also in a way giving opportunities to Sony to be able to start working on that. Now, there's a lot of ifs and buts in this area. We don't know what will happen. We don't actually know what's possible over USB-C on the Sony cameras. We don't know what Sony is planning to implement, but I do think we are going to see, let's say, a revival or a speeding up of some of the applications that we are seeing that are possible between cameras and especially tablets in the beginning. And to be fair, mostly at this moment Apple, because we still have to see how Android will react to it. So I am gay. I am hoping that they mean it in a positive way, Pro Kevin, because you know that the gay before sort of meant happy. So well, I'm not in a bad mood, so that's okay. So if there are any more questions, or there are questions, please put them in the chat, then we can talk about these topics. Another topic that I want to talk about before we get questions and people join in is that hardware project I'm working on. So some of you might know that I've been involved in developing some of the L brackets for the A7 III, and sometimes I will stand up just to see if I'm nicely into the framing. So these L brackets that some of you are using, which are about 20 millimeters high and they have a certain weight, and I hope you enjoy them. They by now have sold quite a few. And we also developed I was involved a little bit in the development of this one, which can work as a video grip, and it automatically sort of protects your HDMI connections when you hook it up. And if people have a question, I can show you how that works. But actually, I'm quite excited about a new part that I'm got involved with, which is actually this little part. So if you are a hybrid shooter or even doing video shooting, then you probably have used cages. And this is kind of, so the L brackets are kind of like slowly becoming cages, if that makes sense. And one of the reasons why you want to use a cage sometimes, as a hybrid shooter especially, is that you can add extra things on top, right? Like, for example, a microphone. So these cold shoes, so far, they never had a lock. So if you slide something in, let me take the fluffy part off. So if you slide it in, boom, 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 boom. Here you go. There's always a danger that it would fall off, right? And if you have a wireless receiver or something like that, then, well, it's quite dangerous, not because there's much value there, and there might be 200 or 300 euros of stuff there, but because the cable is connected to your camera again, and it might sort of damage the camera. So actually, I'm now working with a small rig to create one of these cold shoes with an actual lock on it, so that you can lock it down, and it can't, even if it's not fully locked down using the dial, that it still is not able to get out. So that I'm quite excited about that. So I still don't see any questions, which is kind of a pity. So hopefully more people will join, or I picked the wrong time moment, and then, well, we'll see later today if I do another one, if that makes more sense for timing. Or maybe Sunday is just not a good idea. So another topic that I at least wanted to talk about is what we are going to see next from Sony. I think there's a lot of hints and a lot of questions of people sort of waiting for the A7 S3 and the A6500 replacement on what kind of features will be coming in. I just wanted to point out in this topic that the area where I think Sony will sort of start taking another, let's say, jump or advancements over some of the other brands. So what we are seeing now is that, I wouldn't say they are matched, but the other brands are sort of jumping ahead in a few areas where Sony is now showing some weakness. So we can talk about the encoders, which are in there for video, but I think one very obvious one is the EVF, for example. And I think one thing we will see on the A7 S3 is actually an improvement on the EVF and the LCD, simply because they are now behind Canon and Nikon in that area. And the reason why I think that is happening is also if you think about it in the reverse, right? So Nikon and Canon actually had to make a really nice EVF because they are trying to get their people, their users, away from an optical viewfinder. So the quality of the EVF had to be quite high, which is a little bit more expensive, of course, and that's why Sony did put quite a good EVF into the A7 R3, but a little bit less in the A7 III normally. But the funny part is that most of the EVFs in the world that are made by Sony, so the EVFs in the Canon and Nikons, for Nikon, I'm sure, for Canon is just me sort of guessing, inside are probably Sony EVFs. And that means that they can do them if they want to. And I suspect on the next camera, they will actually start pushing that more. And the rumor is that they are going to put in a 5.6 megapixels EVF into the next camera. So, and I think that's a very good sort of move forward if you want to go there. The same is true for the LCD. I think they are now way behind on the LCD, so I think they are going to improve that. I actually think that they are going to release the A7 S3 not as a 12 megapixel one, but as a 18 megapixel or 24 megapixel camera. The reason why I think that is because I think the light sensitivity does not really depend on 12 megapixels. We had a discussion about this on the Facebook group, and the whole idea that the bigger the pixels are, the better the light sort of works is actually not totally correct, because the whole sensor is just a certain size, of course, and the amount of light it can pick up is basically the same for a 12 megapixel sensor or 18 or 42 megapixel sensor. And it's more about the loss, basically what kind of efficiency does the sensor have, what the end result is in light sensitivity. And if they do a higher pixel count, so let's say 18 or 24 megapixels, you will get a much sharper image. It's pretty clear with both the A7 III and the A6500 and even the A9, which has a very good downscaling algorithm in there. that the end result of downscaling a higher pixel count to 4K material, so either from 5K or from 6K or even higher, and scaling it back to 4K actually gives better results. So I think Sony will probably go for an 18 or 20 megapixel sensor. I'm kind of a little bit worried about that there's no questions being asked, because we did two small test sessions before, and actually I saw quite a lot of questions. So either this is a wrong time moment for people to join in, and just to make sure, I'm going to walk around and see on my computer if everything is okay and the streaming is done correctly. I will also check the sound a bit. No, the sound is fine, so that can't be the problem. So I was hoping for a few questions so that we could react on. If there are no questions, then I'm a little bit in trouble. No, it seems to be everything is fine and the stream is up. And the only reaction so far is from Pro Kevin, which only sent one line. So I will just put something in the chat myself to see if it works. Let me type a message back to Kevin. Maybe he's still with us. Yep. So the chat is still working. I was hoping that more people would join and we can actually answer our questions. I guess it's also very unpredictable about the internet, right? I've put about 300 videos online now about the A7 III and the A7 R3, and also some of the older cameras. So let me give you some generic information, because I still want to be able to... we see more people now joining. Yeah, I'm also kind of trying to figure out what is the good time moment. So let me give, if people are listening to this when it's archived, because I'm probably going to leave it online, is the idea here is that on the Facebook group and on the YouTube channel, we have talked about many, many topics. And one of the things I wanted to do is use these maybe weekly chats sort of to point back people to the correct videos, or say, yeah, we have talked about this, please use the search and to search for this topic. For example, today on the Facebook group, there were several questions about IEF, and is there one mode or is there two mode, and how does it actually work? And then I just point to a video I've made a few months ago explaining it. Not that my videos are the best videos in the world, but it will help people sort of along. And I think that's the whole idea about the Facebook group. Not really as a money-making sort of thing. I just do this for fun. But why wouldn't we help each other if we can at certain time moments? So, and the same is over here. I'm trying to figure out what is a good time moment, what is a good format for me to do it, so that it's not too much work. But if somebody has a question about how to find something in a menu, or he missed a video, or she has missed a video, that we can actually talk about it. So we have a question from Jones, DP Jones. I got one about lens profile for the 24-105 Lightroom 6. Aha. Well, I just have to guess here, because I'm, I guess, a sucker. I kind of like, to be fair, the whole new method of how Light of Adobe is doing it. So the subscription model. Now, I know there's a lot of back and forth on the topic, but I myself have a gut feeling that the Lightroom 6 might not be supporting all the lens correction for you. So I'm not sure if that is a smart idea. I would really consider, if I was you, to go to one of the CC versions. Again, this is just my gut feeling, and I know that there are different views on this, but I would consider most of the software free, and that you are paying for basically the storage, the backup, and the transport between devices. Because one nice thing about the new Lightroom setup is that you can use it on all your devices at the same time. So if you look at my channel, you will find multiple videos where I'm actually in the last few months trying to use only my iPad when I'm on the road as sort of an input mechanism, a backup mechanism, and using Lightroom, and as I, what I talked about before, Photoshop being released pretty soon, and can I do the total workflow there? And the nice thing about that, it will also automatically transport it to the cloud, so it will start backupping and then automatically sync them back to your main computers, which is really nice. Now, it's a long introduction to tell you that I don't know what specifically is in Lightroom 6 available. I do see a lot of questions about people asking it, when will certain versions be available, when will certain lenses be supported, when will certain cameras be supported, why can't I open my RAW file because the camera has been out for 3 months now. My guess is that Adobe will be getting worse and worse in supporting the old versions. It's already very confusing. I think my computer now has 3 or 4 different versions of Lightroom and Photoshop, and I have no idea why one is called CC and the other is called the Classic and the other is called whatever. I think they will be slowly only moving to the model which is the online model, and that will always be online. So, hello, Mark. I'm not sure if that was a correct answer for you, DP Jones. So financially challenged right now, what about the plugin? Okay, yeah, well, I find it difficult. I must say that I think the cheapest Lightroom subscription is now, I think, about $10 or $12 a month. So I don't know if there's also other applications, and I'm not sure actually that might be one. There's also an application that I've only used on the iPad called Affinity. And of course, you can also look to the Phase 1 one that Sony kind of gave you for free with the camera. And that might be much more up to date. I know there's a lot of people who are actively starting to hate on Lightroom and going to the Phase 1 solution. So that might be something that you might look into, because I'm guessing that that will be quicker updated because of the relation that they have with Sony. So, and you can also ask in the Facebook group, because I know a lot of people have experience with that. So, good morning, Mark. We are slowly trying to figure out if this is a good time to do these sessions. I know you already joined one of the test sessions yesterday, I think. You can probably give me some feedback about the video quality and the audio quality. I try to work on it a little bit, and hopefully the audio is much better now. And I also made the video quality 1080p now, and I upped the bitrate. So, more questions, please, because so far not too much in the questions. Yeah, okay, and also I think that's also a good one, and maybe also an introduction. Thank you, Mark. The Phase 1 has better integration for tethering. I think, now that I think about it more, I think most people should probably look both at the Phase 1 solution and at Lightroom. And I would not be surprised, depending on what you are doing, that Phase 1 is actually a better option for you, both in price, but also in the quality of the image coming out. The reason that I personally am is kind of betting, I would almost say, on Lightroom and Photoshop to fix their software is actually two reasons. I want to slowly start moving to a much more portable setup. So I have set my hopes on basically including tethering, that at some point in time, Photoshop and Lightroom will be so powerful on the new devices that I can keep using that. So I'm forcing myself away from Lightroom, even the old version, on my desktop, stop, and trying to do it all on the iPad. But it's more like an exercise in how far are we than maybe practical. So I will definitely look into it. On the tethering front, I think Mark, you just joined in, if I'm correct. So I already talked a little bit about what the iPod, the new iPads are now doing. Sorry if I sound like an Apple fan. That's maybe partly true, but just because they are now building in stuff that might be interesting for us photographers and video people. But they are adding now USB-C, and I think I'm looking forward the moment that somebody, but I'm hoping it will be Adobe also, that starts supporting tethering in a much better way, because an iPad, let's say 10 inch or 12.9 inch, is a very powerful tool. They're totally calibrated screens. They're extremely quick, and it's just a few things holding us back. And a few things are quite big things in that they could take a long time for Adobe and Sony and Apple to fix it, but it could also be something that they're working on. And Adobe is actually a good example, because it's a known fact almost that their own old code base, so where Lightroom and especially Photoshop are based on, are decades old. And their mobile team is rewriting everything. And what we are seeing now, luckily, is that the code base which is created by these new developers, which started off as the mobile applications, are now slowly taking over the let's say the grown-up versions. And as a result, I'm quite hopeful now that Apple is moving to USB-C connectors, that we are seeing this new code base kind of evolve into the only code base, so that things like speed will be much better than in the old version, because Lightroom was never known for their fast code base. So we are finally getting more questions, so that's cool. Mark said, the tethering is... I'm still hoping that we see more from Sony in that area. Yeah, I think, I think the iPad Pro is a game changer, not because of because it's Apple, but I think we will see especially companies like Adobe reacting on that, and reacting on the already very powerful applications we are now seeing out. I kind of forgot the name of the video application, but Affinity for the iPad is kind of like a Photoshop comparable program, and it's extremely powerful. So if you have to compare it with what's happening on the hardware side, where we clearly see that this year Sony pushed it to a level that Canon and Nikon had to jump in and start playing in the sandbox, we are going to see the same thing, I think, on the software side from some of the big companies, that they will now start jumping in and upping their game. So, okay, do I have any old lenses with manual with adapters? Yes, I do, but I kind of are trying to get rid of most of them, because I actually think the native route is the best solution. But that's just my, I think in general, I still have an MC11 that most people have that works. My gut feeling is that we will see more adapters and more, let's say, of a hobbyist crowd around old lenses, because all the other brands, so also the Canon and Nikons, are now in the same areas that they can use adapted lenses. So I think we're going to see a very interesting sort of thing evolve. Also, the tools are getting stronger and stronger. Of course, on the Sony, they were already quite good in doing manual focus and focus peaking and stuff like that, almost turning getting focus into a video game. But again, some of the other brands clearly jumped ahead, and things like peaking and some of the focus tools are not actually that great on the Sony compared to the others anymore. So maybe we'll also see a little bit of an improvement there. Yesterday in the test session, somebody was also asking about this, and you already noticed that the EVF especially and the LCD are limiting in the how well you can do manual focus. And I think that's one area where Sony will probably hit back in updating the EVF and the LCD on the A7 S3, for example, to be able to do better manual focus. I do think that a lot of people, of course, it's tricky for me to talk about as if I know everything, but I do notice that quite a few people, when they're coming into the Sony system, they actually just don't know about certain tricks, right? So being able to zoom into the picture, so magnify a picture, and then do focusing, or do the magnification and then do focus peaking, or that you can quite easily program a switch to go into manual focus and auto focus and then play around a little bit. That is not always known, and several of the videos on my channel are about that. And it's not that people are, well, nobody reads the manual, but they just don't expect certain things to be possible because they have lived for so long in a different, world model. If you're talking about live view versus the, an OVF and versus an EVF. So let's see what else questions we have. Again, I'm trying to get used to this idea, so let's see how this goes. Sorry if we're still finding our way. I have an A6000. I still also have an A6000. I'm also a full-time student photography study. I am saving for free. My question is, would you recommend an A9, an A7 III, or A7 R3 as my next camera? I think all three are great cameras. I do think, I know it's a lot of money. I do think that upgrading from an A6000 to a full frame is actually a very interesting idea. I would not go for the A9, it's too specific. I would consider the A7 III or the A7 R3, and let me try to find why I'm saying this. It kind of depends also on some of the lenses that you have. So even if you're jumping to an A7 III, which is an X amount of money, let's say it's about $2,000, depending on where you are. That's a lot of money, but you also have to consider what kind of lenses you're using it on it. So if you already have a few lenses on the A6000, you might consider, given that the A7 R3 is a little bit priced down at the moment, you can sometimes find it cheaper to actually go for an A7 R3 and keep using your APS-C lenses. Because if you come from an A6000 and you're jumping to, temporarily of course, because you're trying to go from the A6000 to a newer setup, the nice thing about an A7 R3, yes, you will spend $800 more or something close to that, but you can start out with your old lenses, and that might be an interesting way to go. And actually, yesterday when we are talking, I showed two lenses. So this one, especially this one, let me see if we're in the picture. So finally, something is moving on the screen. So this is the 10-18, for example, which is still very useful on a full frame sensor. But if you're using it on an A7 R3, you still have about 18 megapixels left in APS-C mode. And it's actually sharper and better than A6500 or A6300 or A6000. So that might be an interesting way to go. I would never go for the A9, simply because I think it will be replaced somewhere next year. And I think it's also way too specific for you, probably in this case. I do think the A9 is almost like a prototype of what is coming, right? So the only downside, I would say, is that you're missing the future a bit, but it sounds a bit weird. But probably you still have to wait one generation before you get into some of the new things that the A9 are bringing. So basically all the results of being able not to have a shutter and having a way faster sensor so that you can use the silent mode in much better ways. But that's something that will take a few more years to learn anyway, or be to get used to. So hopefully that was a good answer, but you have to make the calculation. I still kind of enjoy the APS-C mode, and also the APS-C mode will keep your lenses small, of course, and it actually becomes a very capable sports shooting device, because with these 18 sharp megapixels, it will get a silly big buffer. For example, you know that some of the, I think the A6000 had a small buffer. You could do about 10 frames a second, if I remember. I still have one over here somewhere. I think it was 10 frames a second already, but the buffer would be filled within seconds or even less. If you're using an A7 R3 and you put in APC mode, you actually get a buffer of 580 shots. So that's also a very interesting thing. So do the calculation for you. I kind of like the A7R3. I think it's a jack of all trades in that way that it's a pretty good full frame camera, obviously, but it's also almost like has an APS-C camera sort of hidden inside. So let's see. So Mark is answering somebody about the Play Memory apps. Not sure what the question was. Let me see if I can scroll back. Please ask more questions or just say hi. Hi, welcome back, Steve Wack. You was also here yesterday, so hopefully you agree with Mark that the audio and the video is better now. So yesterday we also talked, and I see a lot of people jumping in. So I'll talk about it again a little bit about, if you want to, about what's happening with the software side and the Play Memories app. I know some of you have already heard it, but I took these videos down because I consider them more like test cases. So if you all agree and we don't have any other questions, for now, I can talk a little bit about what's happening, in my opinion, because I know a little bit more about it, what's happening with the Play Memories app. There's actually a video on my channel talking about why they killed the Play Memory apps in the cameras, what is happening, and where we are going. And I, what I suspect will be happening, because as a developer, both in hardware and software, I was actually looking into this. And a few days ago, I tried to keep myself informed in that area. So Play Memories, just a quick recap. Play Memories is kind of confusing because it's different things in different places. We first had Play Memories apps in our cameras up to the A6500. They killed them. And we can scream and complain about it, but they killed them for a pretty good reason. They were not that great in how they were implemented. It was running in the camera an Android operating system version. So that sounds nice because you can have apps, but the apps were kind of separated from the rest of the camera. And the downside was that A, they were very slow, but also the settings were not basically taken from one side to the other side. So it sounds very nice, for example, that you can do focus stacking, or that you can use the your iPhone or your Android device to watch the video. But since it was not implemented in the correct part of the camera, if that makes sense, the settings would not automatically get copied over. So what they did, they actually threw away the internal Play Memory applications. They rewrote most of the operating system. That's why the new generation is so much faster and, in my opinion, also more stable. And they actually only ported very few apps inside to the core firmware of the camera. The most important one is everything that was needed to support, and now it gets confusing, to support the external Play Memory apps. So using either Wi-Fi or the connection, the applications running on the other side are also called Play Memories. And the only thing that they kind of ported from the old Play Memories application inside your camera, they ported the PC remote part. And that got improved quite nicely. Now the bad news is, I have to start my YouTube here again, sorry. Something went wrong there, and I want to make sure that we are still transmitting. The nice part is that, and the bad part in a way, is that Sony is rewriting the protocols, or what we as developers call API protocols, so that the way that you can connect to the camera, so that's either using Wi-Fi or using the USB connection, right? And maybe also, by the way, depending on which camera you have, over the network stack to begin with. So for example, on the A9 you have the Ethernet port. That's unclear. We can talk to the camera, but the Sony has actually closed up the software development. So up to 2017, I think about April, they were quite open in sharing the APIs and the programming documentation to developers, and you could download an SDK, and you got sort of could find your way around how to talk to the camera as a software developer. They actually took them down and started changing the protocols. Now, that sounds like bad news, and it probably is also bad news, but it might also be temporarily. And what I mean with this, Sony seems to be quite open in all the other areas, so like the mount, and it might be a temporary thing until they have rewritten all the APIs the way that they want to, and then opening it up again. So if you're talking to these interfaces as a developer, you can actually ask for all the features that it has. So you can ask, do you have a certain API? And what we notice is that the APIs, because we don't have the documentation anymore, depending how you ask the camera, you get sort of a list back of all the APIs that are supported. And we see hints that some APIs are available or kind of hidden inside, but we can't figure out how they work yet, or they're not available in a certain mode. So things like, for example, focus, there's actually an API in there that you can do touch to focus on an external application. And it seems to be implemented for the tethering software, but I don't think you can use it, for example, over the Wi-Fi protocol. So that means that applications like the Play Memory apps, or the one that I've been involved with, I've been beta testing last year for a program called Field Monitor for iOS, which you also will find a video on my channel about that. That application, I don't think it's able to use the touch to focus one yet. The good news is that we know that Sony is fiddling around with it. So that is always better news that they are not working on it anymore, which we also have seen in different cameras. But actually, Sony is rewriting stuff and changing stuff, and we are all hoping, again, getting back to the USB-C standard, that at some point, for example, we can not only get the video signal out of the display port, which kind of would be a way to get the video out of the USB-C connector, but they could also just as well put it as more like a software stream or over the normal data line of the USB-C, and that will be getting close to tethering, right? So if you think about tethering and what kind of APIs you need, having access to the live video stream, but just as data, would also be very useful. So we have to wait what Sony is doing. Sadly, as we all know, especially everybody on the Facebook has complained about it, some of the easiest software fixes Sony could do, they actually didn't do in the last firmware. So Sony seems to be much less reacting to, let's say, software questions that we have compared to hardware questions. Hopefully that will change over time, because some of the other brands are actually doing a better job in supporting external applications. So, okay, more questions. I bought three Samsung over the last 2 years, and the Lau F2 sold them all, and Find Nate is sharper. Yeah, I think my gut feeling also is that I try to stay with native lenses. I have to admit that I also try to limit myself to a certain amount of lenses that I can put in my bag and take with me. So that's, everybody has different reasons why they want to have certain lenses. Some just for the feeling of them, some because they want to have manual focus, or they want to do follow focus for video. One of the pet peeves that I have personally is that I want to make sure that they fit in my camera bag, and that I kind of have a maximum if I'm traveling what I can take with me. So for example, although I do like prime lenses, I try to limit myself on a practical level to zoom lenses, and then you end up that the native lenses are the best compromise, the smallest and the sharpest, etc., etc. So actually the three zooms that I always have with me is the 16-35 GM, the 24-105 G, and the 100-400 GM with the teleconverter, and that gives you such a huge range. I do plan to also add, I also have the two primes with me, are the 55 1.8, which a lot of people have, and I want to also add a 24 1.4, because I can still kind of fit that in my bag if I want to. So I think there's a lot to be said about native lenses versus adapted lenses, and I would also and we have in on the channel. I understand the same as the question with the APS-C lenses before. I understand many people want to take their lenses from Canon, for example, into the new system. But I think having at least one native lens, a modern native lens, does give you kind of a balance of what the quality is and where we are going. And funnily enough, I'm sorry if I'm rambling, but funny enough, we are now seeing also, especially on the Canon side and not so much yet on the Nikon side, that the newer lenses coming out are actually of better quality, right? So they are going to say, well, this is about the mount and it's a better mount and Sony can't do this, etc., etc. It is also partly simply because of the way that the lenses are designed now, right? They are designed in a totally sort of different decade most of the time. So there's a lot of improvement with the computer-aided design in getting the lenses better. The coatings are way better. The flange distances also helps. And what you will see is that also in Canon, by the way, I think once they go, we have more native lenses for the new mirrorless, you will see on average they are higher quality. And even weirdly, it's true in the reverse, where we see that Sony has not done a lot on the APS-C lenses, and we see Fuji releasing really nice lenses because they're also modern, modernly designed lenses, and they are just sort of a higher quality. So, okay, next question. I want to probably limit this to an hour, and then we will figure out if this is useful for people. I noticed that we are just sort of talking and haven't shown anything on the camera yet, so maybe there are not questions about that. The good thing about the A7 R3, also you can shoot full frame or crop and save a lot of your native purchasing extra glass. That's what I was talking about before. And I think also there's quite in the video area and even in the photography area, there's a lot of interesting tools. So let me show you a few. Is that you can actually use your prime lenses as zoom lenses, and you can sort of move about. So it's not just that you can use it in two different modes, so crop mode and full frame mode, but you can actually play around within the pixels when you're doing, for example, video. So let me give you an example. Let's put it in video mode. Now we'll turn this back a little bit and zoom in. So here we go. Make it a little bit darker. That's why I kind of set it up, right? So like this. So one of the things, and of course now I'm using a zoom, right? That doesn't really matter too much. So, but let me put this down and put something below this. Oh, it's much more fun if we are fiddling. So one nice thing I think is that if you're using a prime, or even if you're using a prime lens, that in video mode you can actually still use it with something called clear zoom. So if you start out, let's take the A7 R3 as an example. If you start out with 42 megapixels, then you can actually scale down because you only need about 8 megapixels to get 4K video. Of course, you can do that by doing crop, and I've programmed it on the C3 button. So you can see with one press, I can go from full frame mode to crop mode. But what you also can do is that you can actually, and I've programmed it on this button, that you actually can go to zoom, right? So if you press this one, at least what I did, I can now zoom into the picture quite far, and you would be surprised. And of course, you have to convince yourself that this is worth it. But you will be surprised that the loss in quality is not that much. It depends, of course, how far you push this. Let me put a finger below it. But you can see, and this also works on a prime lens, right? So if you are at 50, let's put it at 50. So let's assume that you take the 55 millimeters, which I have now put it on 55 millimeters. You can see that you have quite a big range that you can work with, both as photography, but also in video, and you can actually use it as a zoom lens. And I think that's some of the features that people are not really recognizing, what you get extra. It of course also works on the A7 III, But it works even better on the A7R 3, and you can see, again, this is the range that you would get on a 15mm lens to be able to zoom around. So I think that's also very interesting. And the same is kind of true when you're doing things like punch to zoom, stuff like that. So let's see if there are more questions. There's no control. Well, actually, there is kind of control for focusing in the Play Memories API. Let's call it an API, but it's kind of unclear how we can access it. I do have a gut feeling that Sony is working on it. So we will see what happens. Yeah, on the crop sensor, let's jump. Thank you, Mark, for trying to keep the conversation going. I need some help here. So on the crop sensor, it actually not only becomes 18 megapixels, but I tried using the, I think by that time I still had the 150 to 600 Sigma lens. And I think I did it on the 100 to 400 GM lens. I actually compared the A6500 against the A7R III in crop mode. And to my eyes, the A7R III in crop mode was actually sharper than the A6500 in its normal mode. So there's 24 megapixels versus 18 megapixels. But as we know, the A7R III doesn't have an AA filter. Well, the A6500 does have an AA filter, so that seems to be balancing out. So the 6 megapixels that the A6500 would have as a head start is being totally negated by the fact that the AA filter is making it less sharp. Yeah, I'm not sure, Mark, if it's actually a better sensor, because if you go to the ISO tools on DP Review, it's probably a little bit a better sensor, but sensor development is not going that fast. That I don't think the A7R III and the A6500 are actually purely from a sensor point of view. Let's say the generation that was there were too much difference. I think it's mostly the AA filter that is was causing the problem. So don't underestimate, I think that's Mark and I are both are saying, don't underestimate how good the A7R III can be in crop mode. And like I showed you in the video one, right? It's, oh, I should not go into the voting one. But especially in the video mode, but also in photo mode, it's so much nicer that you can sort of jump in and jump out. That is a feature that many people so sort of, I wouldn't say misunderstand, because that's not the case, but underestimate what you can do with it, even if you are in photography mode. Like I said, I have one video online, if you search for it, which I think the four reasons why crop mode can be better or something, is that not only does the camera, of course, zoom in, so it's easier to find your target, but if you think about the A7R III, it doesn't have full coverage for the face detect. Once you put it in crop mode, it becomes full again. The buffer becomes massively bigger because it is built for 42 megapixel files, and only putting in 18 megapixels each time, yeah, makes it quite a deep buffer. I can actually show you that. That might be, why not? We have some fun. So if I put the camera in normal mode, let me zoom in a little bit. So let's show a few tricks. So I'm now, of course, not in crop mode, right? So if I have, you might have known a button that you, well, it's a bit there, but that's okay. I have, normally if I'm outside, I have a button that puts my camera into a fast mode, but let me now do it by hand. So let's put it on high mode. And you can already see that the buffer, how slowly it sort of goes down. Maybe I should not put it. But you can see it's quite quite good. It's now saving, and we are of course in full frame mode. I will put it in silent mode next. That makes a tiny bit more sense. Of course, we have to wait until the buffer is written out. I am writing to two cards, so that takes a bit. One thing I hope that Sony builds in is that they actually only save to card number one, and then when we are done shooting and it has time, it starts copying to card number two. We've seen a little bit of movement in that area, but not enough. Okay, how much do we still need to write? It's almost done. There it is. So now I can put it in silent mode, which saves me a few shots. But I can also put it in crop mode. So when I'm in video, I have to use a special button. This is also, by the way, a nice one. So if you go into the menu, you can actually use the front on and the back. Also, if you can see that, but you can use the front and the back dial to change settings, right? So that's kind of nice. So if we go into crop mode, so here we go. Now notice what happens if I start shooting at the same rate. So focus and let it go. You can see that the bar hardly goes down, right? And the first time I did it, by mistake, I published a video saying the buffer can go on forever. That turns out not to be true, but you can see why I was thinking this. So this is now taking 8 frames a second with full autofocus, etc., etc. Basically, better quality than the A6500 could do. And you can see how deep this buffer actually is. So, and again, it depends a little bit if you put it into two slot mode or one slot mode. It's now still writing to both slots. But my guess is it's probably taking a few hundred photos now. So that's okay. I think enough about why you should get the A7 R3 and not the A7 III. I think, by the way, the A7 III is great value for the camera. I think it's probably the best value camera at the moment. But the counter side is that I think fundamentally the A7 R3 is a better camera, but it's also more expensive. But people should really consider both options, in my opinion. Is the A7 R weather sealed? No, but no camera is ever weather sealed completely. There's a few things we can say about it. There is a video on my channel about how to improve the weather sealing. So I'm not totally going to show it, but I will show you a hint of what I'm doing. So let me turn the lights up a little bit more and zoom out. You can see that I kind of took a weird solution in many ways. So one of the reasons, so let me in general talk about a few things. I think in the last 5-6 years, I've not seen many problems with people actually having water damage on their Sony cameras. But it is also clear that some other cameras are better protected. There's also no doubt about that. So the question is, where is the reality and what can I do about it? So the weather sealing, if you search for it, and I have a video on my channel, if you look for weather sealing, you will probably find it easy, where I talk about 10 minutes about the whole topic, about how the camera is protected, where it's protected, and where the weak points are, and how you could do something yourself. Now, don't be too scared about using your camera outside. But there are simple tricks to make it even better. The good news is, or the bad news, depending on how you look at it, they now took apart all the newer mirrorless cameras, at least the three big ones, so the Canon, the Nikon, and the Sony one, done by Lens Rental, so you can sort of compare them. It turns out that the Canon is probably on the same level as the Sony, and the Nikon seems to be better in certain areas. And Sony, not sure who, I think it was the product manager, already announced that they are continuing working on it. Now, the weird thing is that the biggest weak points, actually part of the review about how well the weather sealing was, that it was actually quite good, except for one part, the bottom part. So, what is the problem with the bottom part? Let me see if I'm in the picture. Yes, I have to put my iPad down for a second. But you can see the way that I was sort of thinking about it is one of the reasons why I started helping designing this L bracket is because I didn't want to move the door from this part to this part on some of the other brands that have L brackets. I wanted to keep the door in the same location. Why? The door is probably the weakest point, and I will show you why, the weakest point on the camera for weather sealing. And I can probably get another camera and show you if I can find another camera. I will look around and see if I see one somewhere. But the reason for this is that, and I have to take this part out, as you can see what I did, is on the design of the small wick bracket, I really asked them not to move the battery door, because then we get about 2 centimeters of height, where if it's in water, it actually is not touching the bottom of the camera. And what I also did, but I think this is probably better to show that on, well, let me take the door off, why not? So, I removed the door. Let me see if it's now in the picture. There it is. Now you see that there's a small little flap over there that you don't see on mine anymore, because I put a little bit of tape over it. This is actually the weakest point of the whole camera. And let me try stand up and try to get another camera, if I can quickly find one. So that was one of the reasons why I wanted to have a wireless headset on, so I can walk around and find stuff. But then I still have to I found one. So here we have the old A60 or A6000. There it is. Still an amazing camera, even to that they are still selling it today. So if you look at this door, which can't go out, but you see that there is this small sort of flip rubber that you can open up, and the reason why it's there, so that you can put a cable in if you're doing an external power. Now, that actually is not that well in sealing. It's so bad, and if you watch the video I've put online, that if you shine a light through it, you can actually see the holes in this little flap. So the way to easily for 10 cents already help yourself is to put a little bit of tape on the inside and on the outside, and that closes up, I wouldn't say all of the problem, but at least part of the problem. The second thing that I did, but then you have to look at my review of this L bracket, is that since I have the L bracket on anyway, I actually put a little bit of rubber inside the camera. So the weakest point of the camera is basically the underside. So the battery door is, I would say, 80% of the problem, and some of the screws which are the bottom plate are, we have not seen proof, but they are doubtful. The one thing I can say is that both Sony and Canon and Nikon actually did the same thing, because one of the complaints was when they took apart the camera, and I can show it on this one again. You can see that there are, this one is much cheaper, but also on your A7 III or your A7 R3, that is being screwed. There's a plate on the bottom side, and if you take the plate off, you can look right into the camera all the way up to the sensor. And the people at Lens Rental said, well, it's kind of a pity that there's nothing in between. So once water gets behind the back plate, water can go all the way into the rest of the camera. No idea why, but all three brands, so Canon, Nikon, and Sony, did the same thing. It's quite open once this backplate is sort of breached. That does not mean that the plate will be breached with water. So the only place where I know for sure, and also the only test we have seen, actually I'm pretty convinced that the door is the point where the water came in. What I don't understand, especially because this is a movable, removable part, why Sony or somebody else doesn't make a flap and doesn't sell a flap, because I would buy it, that doesn't have this sort of rubbery thing, right? I understand that if you are doing video, sometimes it's handy. It's much less handy than before, because the batteries are now so much better. But if somebody would make a battery door, replacement of this, without the stupid hole, and maybe with a little bit better gasket on there, I think it would sell. So let me go back to the questions and see. This is one of my pet peeves, and as you can see what I did, I also then still put a plug in there to hold the water even better. And you can see the nice thing again for me. And once I put it in there, I kind of also have a place to hide my Peak Design plug. Doesn't look nice, but you're not looking at the back of your camera anyway. And now it's if the battery door is back on, it's well protected. Actually, on the new one we are designing, so the follow-up of this bracket, we will make a mechanism that is more like a door. And I have some new ideas about how to improve the weather sealing on that. So Hopefully this was not a long answer. Okay, more questions. Okay, after 50, I have to scroll back a little bit. So, I'm not sure how to spell your name, but Chiara. So, hopefully this was a big enough answer about the weather sealing. For me, and I know this sounds like a really weird solution, but if you are worried, and we are walking around with quite expensive equipment, look into a good insurance, right? I pay about, I think, 5% for 3 years on all my lenses and my bodies. And they are not only saved for rain, but mostly for me being stupid. So if it gets stolen, if I drop it, and I fell with my camera, and maybe some people are actually, the bracket kind of saved my butt, because another one took most of the hit. But I have my cameras insured simply against me being stupid, but also against water and sand damage. So maybe not the best solution to talk about, and but it is gives you a good feeling at least that you know that your cameras are protected that way, because no camera is actually totally 100% weather sealed, whatever the brands tell you, because they put like a big hole at that that side over there. And at some point, the water will get in. But I hope this was helpful. And again, watch the search on my channel. What I will do, I will try to go back into the chat. And every time that I talk about a certain topic and I have a video about it, I will either see if I can put it in the log file or in the chat itself. I'm not sure if I can edit the chat log after the fact. Not sure. Or I will try to put it in the description, so you have the links to some of the other topics we talked about. So great live chat, all working great. Need to go. Thanks. Thank you, Rex, for joining us. And we will probably try to limit it to an hour, although we are already going longer than an hour. I also need to figure out how to send out invitations so that the first 15 minutes will be a little bit more proactive. I just checked. Yeah, indeed, the crop mode is remembered, and be careful with that. One thing I would prefer if Sony actually, because even if you go into video mode and out of video mode, so as you notice, I programmed the C3 button. Let me tune this down a little bit again. Okay, not sure why you're doing that, so make it a bit darker so that you can see it. So I, in video mode, you see that I programmed it on the C3 button. But it does, if you go back to video, so that happens to me sometimes, if you go back to video, to photo, you will see that it actually doesn't jump back automatically. And, or did it now? Is that something new? Did we actually find? No, see, it stayed into crop mode. And sometimes I forget it. Now, the camera does give you a warning if you're into crop mode on your display. Hold on. So it should be somewhere over there. Come on. So you see the symbol over there, but it's in white, and I really hope that either Sony makes it orange. So I think there's some of the things on the screen that should actually turn into a warning mechanism, because I'm pretty sure Mark has the same thing. We all, at some point, I had it yesterday during the test session that I forgot to take it out of crop mode. They go like, why is my 90 millimeter so far zoomed in? Just for safety, of course, I also put the crop selector over here, because when I'm in photo mode, I actually reuse this button. Sorry, I reuse this button for something different, right? So I now use it to set the silent mode. While in video, I set it to set the crop mode on or off. So if there are no more questions, we will do the same thing at 7 o'clock. So that's it's now just for your 1 o'clock. So in 6 hours, we do another one, just simply to see what timing works best for people. So, Fernando, insurance. My gear insurance in the USA covers me for a lot, but as far as for water damage concerns, I'm only covered for submersion, not rain. So if I fall in a lake, I'm covered, not rain. Yeah, I think the problem with insurance is always we are never sure. That's kind of the not very nice answer. As far as I know, but each country are, of course have different insurance. I am covered for it. But at least it's something that you should research, right? That doesn't mean that you have to be stupid, but everything that gives you a good feeling, at least on that side, is something that you should take into your buying decision. Let's see. I'm using T2. Yeah, there's a, I have a video of how to, at least how I set up the buttons. And maybe I should make a new video how I set all my buttons for video. The problem with these videos, of course, over the years I've made several, but every time that you learn something, you kind of remap your buttons and then you end up with five different videos with five different sort of ways of doing it. I must say the C3 button that I use in three different modes is a good example that has not changed for a while. So as you can see, when I'm doing photo, it becomes my silent shooting. No idea why I can't toggle this one, Sony, right? If I go into, and I've of course sent a bug report about that. Don't think they are going to change it if they don't even change our focus color button. But this one, same button, but you can see it's also two options, right? On or off crop mode, but that one toggles. But in video mode, I use it on the on that one. And on review mode, so if you go back to photo mode, on review mode, I actually put it on voting. Well, we can't vote when we are on a burst, so let me go to this one. You can see that I use it on voting, and I also put it, which is quite nice, you can vote 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 stars, but if you only set it to one option, so maybe I should make it a tiny bit more darker again. So if you only put it on one option, then you see that the voting also works as one toggle. So that makes it easy for you to tag photos that you like when you're reviewing it. So this button has been quite stable for me for a while. But it's a personal preference, right? So again, I also have a video about how I kind of set it up. Okay, if there are no more questions, then let's leave it at that. Please leave some comments if you like this idea about just sort of talking about certain topics for, let's say, an hour a week. Maybe we need to figure out what I talk about if we don't have any questions. But in general, for me, the gut feeling is, and my idea is that I want to point out more small details, and if people have questions, say, oh, but you should look at this, or you should look at this. That might be an interesting way to go. If you are part of the Facebook group, please check the files area. You will find a whole list of about 50 videos, I think, I made with different tips and tricks. It's totally okay if you ask the questions over here and we point you to the videos again. I talked about it yesterday also a little bit. One of the things that is for me a motivation to make these videos, or to try to find a new way of sharing this information, is that I find especially Facebook sort of time forgetful, right? So if something gets posted, it has like a lifespan of maybe a day or 2 days, and unless somebody reacts on it, it will be gone forever. And I totally understand that most people then don't go back and use the search function, or even goes to the go to the files area. And the same is kind of true for YouTube. Once it's gone, it's kind of gone. And I'm hoping that by having these chats, that if somebody asks a question on a certain topic, we can actually pull back some of these older videos and start linking them again. Because there are some really useful, not only on my side, of course, but there are some really useful videos out there for people to learn. And this might be a good way to do that. So let me last time check if there's more questions. No, I don't think so. Oh, thank you for saying goodbye. So we will do another one at 7 o'clock, not because I want to do two a day, but I'm trying to figure out what is a good time. And if you enjoy this, please let me know and we will do a second one and maybe at some point invite other people to join in. But yeah, like I said, leave your ideas, tips how we can improve. I'm not going to turn this into a big show, but we can adapt some things that I'm doing now for future sessions. And see you all on Facebook. If you're not on Facebook group, please join. It's called A7R3 Setup Tips. And there are about 3,500 people now asking questions and answering questions. So see you all next time, and I will review this video myself to see how the audio and the video is, and probably be ashamed of the rambling I'm doing, but that's what it is. So see you in the next one, and bye bye. Now I can say bye bye, but I have to walk back to my computer, get up, oh, here we go, and hit the stop button. So again, bye-bye, let me find the correct window because I don't want to edit it after the fact because I'm still lazy. So see you in the next one, and this is really going to be the end. 3, 2, 1, go.